Sea, in particular, the Kasai region. Stay tuned. Now the story. The crisis in Kasai is the latest in a nation consumed by suffering. Given the United States' longtime support of the violently repressive and undemocratic President Kabila, and given Kabila has not adhered to previous diplomatic agreements or even massive monetary payments to get him to step down, some have little faith in American pressure. Maurice Carney, co-founder and executive director of the Friends of the Congo, was quoted in the November 7th issue of the Atlantic Black Star as saying, "You can understand why the Congolese people basically feel like the U.S. is playing with us and that they are not serious." And here to talk about the latest in the Democratic Republic of the Congo, in particular Kasai, is Mr. Maurice Carney. Mr. Carney, thank you so much for being on A Rude Awakening once again.
Sabrina, it's a pleasure. Thank you for having us back.
Absolutely. Now, this is huge. Kabila is still in power. The United States is supporting. They're supporting that everyone wait until 2018. That the whole nation wait to actually stage these elections that are, as of 2018, would be overdue, 2 years overdue. They're pushing for this.
Right.
What does that mean? How does it relate to what's happening in Kasai? What does that mean as far as Kabila staying in power and the movement to push him out?
Well, interesting that you bring up Kasai, and for your listening audience, the Kasai region of the Congo is in the central part of the country, bordering Angola. And traditionally, historically, relatively peaceful part of the country. However, due to Kabila's extension of his stay in power, he was supposed to be out of power in December 2016, but he has done everything conceivable to remain in power. And what this has done, it has destabilized different parts of the country. And one of the regions that have been destabilized as a result of Kabila's intransigence, let's say, is the Kasai region. And in the Kasai region, Kabila's government was involved in deposing and killing a traditional leader who was supposed to ascend to power in a group called the Kwamina Nsapu. And what this triggered was a response from the followers of the Kwamina Nsapu, who Kabila deposed and killed his government in August of 2016. And since that time, it has unleashed a humanitarian crisis to the point where 3,000 people have lost their lives, 1.5 million people have been displaced, and as of late, the United Nations says up to 600,000 children are on the brink of starvation. So it's really a classic example of how an otherwise political impasse or political crisis has stimulated or triggered a humanitarian catastrophe. So Kabila's stay in power, you ask, what does it mean now that elections have been scheduled for 2018? As opposed to this year. And the short answer to that question is that it means more suffering for the Congolese people. It means more arbitrary arrests. It means more instability. And speaking of which, just yesterday, Sabrina, a couple of our young people with whom we work, Jean-Marie Colongi and Sylvain Bakayi of the youth group Captain Bois,
yes.
They were arrested again yesterday by security forces.
Oh my God.
And Jean-Marie himself was beaten badly. In fact, today they were arrested and released on the same day. And today he's at the doctor's in the hospital getting care. It seems, and as you've covered a number of times, that Jean-Marie Silva and the young people have been consistently brutalized and attacked by the Congolese government We believe at this stage, certainly they're being targeted, because this is the third time that Jean-Marie has been arrested in the last 2 years, and the government is carrying out a practice of intimidation, trying to demoralize the youth, trying to deter anyone from really standing up and challenging Kabila and his attempt to hold on to power. So whether it's in Kasai, with the children suffering, or it's in Kinshasa with the youth being consistently brutalized and arbitrarily arrested, that the maintenance of Kabila in power for at least another year means more suffering for the Congolese people, more instability, and that should be of concern to all of us. Mm.
Now, I definitely want to turn our listeners' attention to the November 7th article in the Atlantic Black Star, entitled Democratic Republic of Congo Humanitarian Crisis Brings History of Western Interference and Internal Strife into Focus. Now, it's also reported that there was an actual interview. They were quoting another interview that Kabila actually did. He actually sat down and did an interview with Spiegel magazine. I think it's a German outfit. And he's saying that we are not going to finance elections when we need to fight to win back occupied territory. Now, what exactly does he mean by occupied territory? Are we talking about these multinational corporations that go there to mine for the stones and whatnot that we use to make our computers, our phones, etc.?
Well, it's certainly not that. You know, Joseph Kabila is given unfettered access to Western corporations, unfettered access to the minerals in the Congo, whether it's the cobalt and gold or the copper, you name it. So he's not talking about that. That's an interview from earlier in the summer. What he may be referencing is the instability in the East, where militia group M23 was sponsored by neighboring countries, primarily Rwanda, and they had occupied territory in the east of the country and displaced up to a million Congolese. So the Congolese government, in coordination with the United Nations and a special deployment of troops on the part of several southern African nations, including Tanzania and South Africa. South Africa in particular, Tanzania, Malawi, came in and worked with the Kabila government to displace the militia group. But what you and that's an important point that you bring up, though, because what Joseph Kabila stated, the Kabila government, or not solely the government, but the Independent National Electoral Commission, although they set the date for elections in 2018, it's conditional. They said, well, this date that we've set for elections is conditioned upon whether we have enough money, whether there is the security situation has calmed down. So there's like a host of caveats that they've laid out, which makes their declaration or the calendar that they've presented to the world dubious at best.
So wait a minute. You're saying that if it all depends on if they have enough money. Kabila has been robbing and pillaging the country since he's been in power. I mean, we're talking over two decades.
Yeah, but here, that's his personal money that he's taken from the state, from the people. He's not going to put that. That's the contradiction, though. That's what you see. We have a situation where the elites, Kabila leading the leading elite, pilfering the country, pillaging the country, resulting in lack of resources for the Congolese people. The Carter Center did a study, a really big study recently, where they looked at resource exploitation in the Congo and the contracts that the Congolese government has established with mining corporations. They basically laid out how in one particular scenario where there is up to $750 million that has just vanished from the state coffers, dollars that came in presumably from taxes that were paid by corporations that are involved in the exploitation of minerals in the Congo. So this has been systematic, the systematic looting of state coffers, not only to the point where they don't have funds for or resources for elections, but when you talk about clean drinking water or electricity, where less than 10% of the population has access to electricity, or funds for health care, which is virtually non-existent, or education. So you have a system in place in the Congo, and it's really consistent throughout the African continent, where you have these local elites who work in cahoots with multinational corporations to pillage the Congo, to pillage Africa, and the results of that pillaging is that you have millions of people suffering. There's no way that children should be starving in the Congo. It's a country that has full growing season, has the agricultural capacity to feed the entire world. You drop a seed and it grows. So how is it that you have children starving in a country with such a bounty? That's really the question people ask is, why is it that Africans are suffering to the extent that they are? Why is it that Africans are poor? And the fact of the matter is, Africa is not poor. Africa is spectacularly wealthy in terms of natural resources, in terms of agriculture, you name it. But there's a system in place where you have these local elites who are in cahoots with foreign corporations, and they go about literally robbing the continent. And when and these local elites are, in a lot of instances, are backed up, you know, by Western governments in the United States and in Europe. This is what these young people, the Jean Maries and the Silvers, are fighting against, not only to rid themselves of the local elites like Kabila, but also to confront the foreign corporations that are a part of this process or this system of looting the continent that renders the people impoverished, that renders the people dependent, and this is the this, I guess you can say, this Gordian knot, so to speak, that they're trying to break.
All right, we're going to take a quick break here. Over the past two decades, 6 million people have perished in the Democratic Republic of the Congo, and yet another crisis due to the hypocrisy and the just sheer corruption of the Kabila regime. We're going to speak some more to Mr. Maurice Carney, Executive Director of the Friends of the Congo organization based out of Washington, D.C., after this short musical break. Stay tuned. Maurice Carney, appreciate you being on A Rude Awakening. Once again, we truly appreciate you giving these updates, these very necessary updates about what's happening in the Democratic Republic of the Congo. And I just want to make a connection to folks here in the United States, here in the, you know, just in the West in general, why what's happening in in Africa and in the Democratic Republic of the Congo in particular, why that is, that's important, why we need to know. Can you tell our listeners?
There are a few things, Sabrina. You stated at in the transition that an estimated 6 million Congolese have lost their lives in what the United Nations says is the deadliest conflict in the world since World War II. And we have a situation where if you look, for example, in the news of late, people may be familiar with the four U.S. soldiers that were killed in Niger and the controversy that has arisen as a result of that, you know, with Donald Trump and the widow of one of the soldiers that was killed. And that opened up an avenue for conversation around U.S. military presence on the African continent. And, you know, Lindsey Graham famously said, I didn't know we had soldiers in Niger like that, which is not really, really true. He knew what was going on. But what we got a window into is the militarization of the African continent. That is to say, the extent to which the United States is present on the African continent, particularly through special operation forces, and especially since the advent of the Africa Command, AFRICOM, that was established by George Bush in 2008 and accelerated exponentially by President Obama during his 8 years in office, where U.S. military footprint on the continent increased by some 2,000% over that that time. But the point really want to bring home is the extent to which the continent has been militarized, and that it didn't just start with Niger. The conflict that we see in the Congo, the aggressors against the Congolese people were two U.S. allies, Rwanda and Uganda in particular. And the United States provided those countries with training, with financing, with equipment, with intelligence. As they invaded the Congo, both in 1996 and again in 1998, and to this day, they continue to support those countries militarily. And what happens when, what we see in the results of this, and we see it in our cities here in the United States, whether it's in Oakland or in Ferguson, Baltimore, where you have an enlarged investment in the police force or in the security forces. And what that does is it strengthens the security forces. And as we see, particularly in the black community, the same thing happens in Africa when U.S. supports strongmen on the African continent. The police force then uses that equipment, uses those resources to repress the population, to make communities a virtual police state. So the same thing happening here in U.S. cities, where through the 1033 program, for example, where excess military equipment is sent to local communities, and those communities are militarized. The same thing happened on the African continent. When the U.S. sends soldiers or sent equipment or money, it militarizes those nations, and it strengthens the state. And for the most part on the African continent, security forces, as we've seen in the Congo, are used not necessarily to protect the nation, but to repress the people. So that the militarization that takes place here domestically through programs like 1033 and the militarization that takes place on the African continent are really two sides of the same coin. And when you militarize the security sector, then, of course, the economy suffers, the education suffers, the social welfare program suffers, just like we see in our cities here in the United States, whether it's in Chicago, Baltimore, Ferguson, you name it. Heavy investment in security forces, sucking resources away from those sectors that are vital to the well-being of communities. Right. So that's what's happening. That's what's happening in several countries on the African continent, just as it's happening here in the United States in key cities where we have an overall policy of prioritizing the military, prioritizing the security sector over the economy, over education, over health.
Okay.
So that's a dynamic that's unfolding on the continent with militarization that we see, and the American public has just become recently aware of.
Yeah, and we all need to take a look at what's happening, and we all need to shine a light, the spotlight on the DRC because of it being the hub of being such a mineral-rich country.
Yeah, it's so central to the African continent. The Democratic Republic of Congo, it's a country that straddles the equator, literally and figuratively the heart of Africa. Mm-hmm. It's a country the size of Western Europe, one of the largest countries in the world with an estimated population of 80 million people. Unlike any other country on the African continent, it's bordered by 9 other African countries, so whatever happens there immediately affects a third of the continent.
Mm-hmm.
It's arguably the richest country in the world in terms of natural resources. Some economists say there's an estimated $24 trillion in natural wealth in the Congo. Mm-hmm. It is a storehouse of strategic and precious minerals that are vital to the functioning of many Western industries, whether we're talking about a technology industry. Just down the road there from you in Silicon Valley, coltan that comes from Congo is key. The tin, the copper, there's a big push in the green industry today, particularly in the automobile sector, in the development of electric cars. Mm-hmm. Electric cars cannot function without cobalt.
Mm-hmm.
The entire industry, just about, virtually, relies on the cobalt coming out of Congo. Congo is the largest producer of cobalt in the world, and Tesla, VW, Toyota, you just name it, all of them are going to be needing that cobalt coming out of the Congo in order to power their electric vehicles, in order to for these mass storage batteries. Cobalt is critical. And Amnesty International just published a report just this past week that looks at how children in the Congo are suffering in the mines as a result of the extraction of cobalt to fuel the electric car industry, to fuel the batteries that we use in our cell phones and our laptops. Right. Any rechargeable battery that we use requires cobalt. So if you own a laptop, you own a cell phone, whatever batteries that you have that's recharging, cobalt is a critical component, and the extent to which we use it has an impact on Congolese people, and particularly the children in the mines who are mining that cobalt. It just brings brings home that President Kabila, he has provided unfettered access to those resources that are fueling industries in the West, and this is what the young people are fighting so that they can control the resources of the country. They can set the terms. They can regulate how the minerals are mined or whether or not they're even mined and who benefits from them. Because there's no way, if there's an estimated $24 trillion of wealth in the Congo, there's no way that 70-80% of the population be living on less than a dollar a day.
Let me ask you this. Less than a dollar a day, folks are surviving. In the DRC, folks are surviving off of less than a dollar a day. It is a travesty.
As they sit on top of spectacular wealth.
As they sit on top of
spectacular wealth. That's vital to the functioning of our industry.
I want to ask one more question, though, because we're running out of time, and I definitely want to get an answer from you, because I know you're gonna lay it out. These proxy governments, the Rwandan government, the Ugandan government, allies of the United States, they are facilitating through the militarization of the various communities within the Democratic Republic of Congo, the borders that they have with the DRC. How are these proxy governments propped up United States allies, how are they funneling or facilitating the extraction of the raw materials, these natural resources from the DRC?
Right. Well, the DRC government itself is facilitating it. So that's one.
Right, but how are they involved?
But in a country like Rwanda, for example.
Okay.
Today, Rwanda is a neighboring country of the Congo, and it's the largest producer, according to the statistics, of coltan in the world. However, most of the coltan is found in the Congo. So what Rwanda does in using proxy forces and destabilizing the east of the Congo, that coltan is then smuggled into Rwanda, where it's basically distributed to the world as Rwandan coltan. But it comes out of the Congo, where it's being smuggled in because the Congolese state, the Congolese government, doesn't fully control its eastern borders. So Rwanda has access, relatively easy access to the coltan or to the cassiterite or tin. And by the same token, Uganda has access to Congo's gold or Congo's timber. And this is well documented. The United Nations said of Rwanda and Uganda that they're the mafia dons of the looting of the Congo. Mm-hmm. And International Court of Justice even ruled against Uganda in 2005 for Uganda's pilfering of Congo's resources and committing crimes against humanity, mass crimes in the Congo. So now what happens, Sabrina, is that when international bodies attempt to hold these leaders accountable, like Rwanda, for example, the United Nations looking to sanction Rwanda for its destabilizing of the Congo, you have the United States that run political or diplomatic interference to block any kind of accountability. So that's where the U.S. comes in that particular case. Now, I know we're short on time. What I'd like to share with the listening audience, particularly as it relates to the children in the Kasai, the Presbyterian Church has issued an appeal to people of conscience to support a campaign that they have calling on for relief funds for the children in the Kasai. And if you visit Friends of the Congo's Facebook page, that's facebook.com/ Friends of the Congo, you'll be able to see, get access to that petition where you can send a letter that they've drafted to members of Congress, to the Secretary of State Tillerson, calling on them to take action and to support the relief efforts that is in dire need of assistance to the United Nations efforts. I think the Presbyterian Church has its own efforts going as well. So there's a way for people who are concerned about those children who are on the verge of starvation where they can take some action. Right. By visiting us on our Facebook page.
Absolutely. You can always get updates at friendsofthecongo.org, friendsofthecongo.org.
Yes.
And you guys also are on Twitter at Friends of the Congo or Friends?
At Congo Friends.
At Congo Friends.
At Congo Friends.
Twitter at Congo Friends. Mr. Maurice Kearney, Executive Director of the Friends of the Congo, based out of Washington, D.C., thank you so much for giving us yet another update. Disturbing, but information that we need to have here in the United States and abroad. We appreciate you taking the time. Kind sir, thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Sabrina. I really appreciate you.
All right. And that does it for another edition of A Rude Awakening. I'm Sabrina Jacobs. A big thank you to my guest, Mr. Maurice Kearney, for taking the time. The lovely Erica Bridgman is on the controls. I'll be back next week, same time, same place. Hard Knock Radio is up next. Have a wonderful week of resistance, community, and thank you for listening.
Good day, KPFA listeners. The Craneway Crafts Fair, KPFA's 47th annual holiday benefit, is shaping up beautifully. The fair takes place December 16th and 17th from 10 a.m. to 5 p.m. in the gorgeous, light-filled Craneway Pavilion on the Richmond waterfront. We are ready to sign up volunteers to assist the exhibitors on Saturday and Sunday, plus setup on Friday. We will sign you up for a three-hour shift. The artisans and KPFA will sincerely appreciate your support. There will be 200 booths of original arts and crafts, festive food, and live entertainment at the Craneway Crafts Fair, December 16th and 17th. This is a fun chance to give back to KPFA. To sign up, please email volunteer@kpfa.org or call Kim at 510-848-7777. 6767.